So today was a dream of mine, not in terms of like a long-term dream. It was a dream that I woke up last August. I'm a member of the Baha'i Faith, and last year was the 200th anniversary of the birth of Baha'u'llah, and his teachings are all about unity and oneness. And so I woke up this one morning in August, and I went, you know, we need to have an Interfaith Choral Festival. We have churches and faith communities all over around town who have choirs who sing to each other, to their congregations every week, and we never get to hear each other. And so we need to come together and sing together. And so that's where this idea started from. Robin Kuser, Tom Mahalik, John Marquez were really key. We started to get together and talk about how this might work. Eric Dozier entered the equation, and then it completely took another path, which has been fantastic and wonderful. And so it's not us singing for each other, but it's singing with each other. Maybe that's even better. So I have contacted maintenance, because I see some fans going, to see if we can get the AC drop down a little bit, because it is warm in here. But you didn't come for me, so I'm going to turn it over to Eric. Would you please welcome from Nashville, Tennessee, Eric.
All right. Woo, it is hot in here. It's going to get hotter because gospel is hot. It's a hot genre of music. I mean, like, heat-wise. I was so happy when I got up this morning and it wasn't like 85 degrees at 8 a.m. because it was in Nashville. And we're hitting our summer pretty hard right now. But how y'all doing?
Great.
I'm just making sure we were having mic problems earlier. Well, I'm so glad to be here in Hastings. I heard this was the home of Kool-Aid. Yes. It just took me back to summer times. I grew up in a little town called Bakewell, Tennessee. And, I'm a gospel artist. I'm a storyteller. And I'm a cultural activist who believes that a lot of the social issues that we have now are due to estrangement. We don't know each other. And a lot of them can be solved through proximity and frequency. And we have to do that with intention. And I've chosen my vehicle, and it's music, and specifically through the gospel choir format, because that music has always carried those seeds of hope within it. And raise your hand if you know this song. He's got the whole world. Oh, but you know, okay. This little light of mine, what you gonna say? This little light of mine. Y'all should have started singing when I sung to you, because now you can't tell me that you can't. Okay, let me think. Gonna lay down my burdens down by
the riverside.
Okay, that's good. So listen. Every time, no matter where I've been, and I've been to a lot of places, all over the world, and every time I do that, everybody sings. How is that? You know, and we talk about music being a unifier. That is the quickest way to get somebody into community. And I've done that in Japan, I've done it in South America, I've done it in South Africa, Ghana, all over Europe, Australia, New Zealand, no matter what. But everybody has a connection to this music somewhere. And so that's why I believe that it is very, very possible to unify this world one song at a time. And that's what we do, and that's how I've lived my life and what I love to do. But enough of that. We're going to get to some singing because there's some more talking later on down the road. Because I got to tell y'all about Papa and Meemaw and all my folks in Bakewell, Tennessee. Because that's where I got my music from. I didn't go to school to get it. I got it from all of my folks who I'm very, very proud of. And we're going to fix this. Chad, look at me. Where's Chad Hatcher? Oh gosh. Now, keep in mind that we have not been rehearsing all week. We've been rehearsing all day. We started at 10, and we're going to do what we learned today, aren't we?
Yes.
And, you know, we're going to sing boldly.
Yes.
Inside jokes. Gonna be a great day when we gather in that kingdom. Great day when we gather in that kingdom. No more separation. We're gonna call in every nation. So get ready for the great coronation in that kingdom. Yeah. Can I repeat that? I hope you can right now. Ready? One, two. Gonna be
a great day.
Ready for
away for like one day? That's great. Wow. That is hot up here.
You know, when I do these workshops, I don't just teach the music. You know, you can learn the music.
Black music is pervasive in the United States. And it sits at the root of all of the music that we learn. Whether you're talking about blues, jazz, rock and roll, old time American music. Yep, we were there too. And so you know the music. You hear it all around you. You see its influences. So if you want to just consume the music, it's very easy to do that. But I consider myself to be a cultural ambassador. And because I use the music to make myself known to the people that I'm working with, and so that I can get to know them. And when Paul Robeson talked about the spirituals, and Paul Robeson was a civil rights leader, human rights leader, a scholar and an athlete, he said that the African American spiritual is like spiritual steel forged by centuries of oppression. And it's hard to talk about black gospel music without referencing the spiritual, when it is the kernel of all black American music and American music in that sense. So we want to share with you a couple of spirituals. Now, Go Down to Moses is a very special spiritual. And I remember reading something at one time by a theologian, his name is Thomas Hoyt. And he said that we should never underestimate the power of a story to create or destroy a worldview. And with Go Down Moses, you see these people taking a story from a book that had been used to actually in their peculiar situation, and I put peculiar in quotes, and here they are taking this same story and inserting themselves directly in it and using it to further along their liberation. Go Down Moses is one of those songs that kind of got outlawed because every time the song would be sung, something would happen. Like, people would come out and see that people had left the plantation, or something, a fence had been knocked down, or a barn had been burned, or something like that. And they started to outlaw singing and drums on the plantations because they said, listen, they're singing again, something is going to happen. But it's called a signal song, and this is one of the songs that they used to sing when Harriet Tubman was coming, or someone was coming to lead them on the Underground Railroad. So Go Down Moses.
Mm-hmm.
go down. There is more about the history of the people that created this music in the music that you will find in thousands of volumes of history books. And that's why I'm a firm believer that if you know this story, then you know me. And not only me, but you know my papa and my mom and the other folks that made me possible, my mom and my dad. Now, you know, what's funny about this music is sometimes to disguise the song, we would put songs that are sad in happy keys, and we would put revolutionary songs in that would probably have more gravitas in these keys to disguise the music. This next song says, in that great getting up morning, fear you will, and it's a song about Judgment Day. And it's a song about stars falling and the moon turning to blood and all these different, all these prophecies from the Bible. But it's so upbeat that when folks were singing it, they were like, oh no, they're just out being happy. But they're singing a revolution. And so we want to share that with you right now.
Very well, very well.
I'm gonna take up the coming of a Savior.
great. I'm always amazed, and I do this all the time, and inevitably someone asks the question, do you ever get tired of doing these songs? And I tell them every time, it's new for me, because it's new for them. And, you know, for me, this was a weekend where I got to expand my community and my family, and also add another chapter to the story that is Black American music. You know, I tell them a little joke, and I say this all the time. You can find it on YouTube. I was talking. They said, "Well, you know, what do you do for a living?" And I said, "I teach gospel music to white people." I've kind of made a living doing that. But I say that because, you know, and I told the story about my grandfather. I brought a video to him. Of the choir that I was working in Canada, it was predominantly white Canadians, with a sprinkling of folks here and there. And he looked at that thing and he said, "Boy, is that what you've been doing for work for the past 10 years? And I was like, "Yeah, that's my job." He's like, "Music is a good job." And then he looked again, and I could see that he was being moved by what was happening, because he said, "You know, you're teaching them the songs that I taught you when you were a little boy." And I said, "Yes, sir." And he said, "You know, that's a good thing." And so I asked him why. He said, "Because that music was never meant to be just for us." You know, when we think about music, and what I was taught about music growing up is that music does not come from you. Music moves through you. So it comes from somewhere else, moves through you, and goes out into the world. And it does work. It does something. So it's not just singing about God's got the whole world in his hands. It's helping to create the world that God has got in his hands. You know, it's not just this little light of mine, you know, which has now kind of in a lot of cases been reduced to a little children's song, but it was a way that black people used music to reconstitute their personhood in a world that said, because you are dark, you are nothing. So you call me dark, I call myself light. That's a powerful statement. That's a powerful statement for young people, for old people, for anybody in a world that is trying to turn you into something that is not light. So to open your mouth and to say, "This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine," is a powerful statement in a dark world. So what I would like to do is I want to share another song. It's kind of a meditation, and you know, it's an interfaith choral festival, so there are a lot of people here from different church communities, but also different religious communities. I happen to be a member of the Baha'i community, and we learned a song that I composed, and it's from the Baha'i writings, and it says, "Noble have I created thee, yet thou hast abased thyself. Rise then unto that for which thou wast created." And so I just want to share that with you all now, because I think sometimes we need to meditate on our unique station as human beings and on the nobility of our soul. So
no! But
know, I often look at the black church also as conservatory, because a lot of times we couldn't go to the conservatories. And, but that institution not only nurtured the Aretha Franklins and the Stevie Wonders and the Ray Charleses, but also the Jesse Normans and the Marian Andersons and the Paul Lewisons that also carried forward the black classical traditions through opera singing, Arne Dedd, and all of these people that learned how to sing with feeling, whether it was classical, whether it was soul, whether it was blues, whether it was R&B, in that environment, in that conservatory known as the Black Church. You know, and I remember being 5-6 years old, and you know, one of my grandmother's sisters or aunts would walk into the church, and they would say, "I want to put that boy on the piano. Put him on the piano." And I would just be thinking in my head, like, "Oh Lord, what is Auntie gonna sing this morning?" And you learn to play under the gun like that, you know. And if you're gonna play, you know, you might be playing something that your grandma wrote on way to church. so you really learn how to have a particular flexibility. But I tell folks is that, you know, that's not just a practice of music, you know, like call and response. It is a theory of our humanity. You know, call and response says that I believe in what you have to say to me so much that I'm gonna allow you to shape me in real time right now. And that's a lot of love, and that's a lot of trust. And so we talked about a lot of that this morning. And that carries over into the music. So you go from a song like He's Got the Whole World in His Hand to a song that was composed by Stevie Wonder that also mirrors that impulse that the world needs love, that the world needs God, that the world needs us to speak and stand up for love. And the song that we're going to share with you right now comes out of that soul tradition, and it's called Love's in Need of Love Today. The words say, "Love's in need of love today. Don't delay. Send it in right away. Hate's going around, breaking hearts. Stop it, please, before it's gone too far. Thank you. Stayed on freedom.
Stayed on freedom.
woke up this morning with my mind
stayed on freedom.
I woke up this morning with my mind
stayed on freedom.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Okay. Got it?
Got it.
That's okay. They just learned it too. Stand up. They just learned it today, so you might as well. Now listen, everybody that was out there wasn't—they weren't singing. Some people were clapping, some people were moving, some people were happy, some people were carrying water bottles, some people were holding signs. It didn't matter. As long, but everybody is always a part of the choir. Okay, everybody, listen. Trust me.
Everybody in church can't sing. I know, but everybody's got a song.
Y'all understand? Y'all got me? Yes? No? Maybe? Okay. I like a yes or no. Call and response tradition. So here we go. We ready?
Let it
coming out and for being here with us. You know, the thing is about this music is that it lives in community. So by you coming out tonight, it gave us an opportunity to be. So to like be a gospel choir, to be, yeah, right now, because they showed up. So thank you all. Thank you all so much. And next time, how many of y'all got friends and relatives up here? Raise your hand. All of you, right? It's Hastings. It's like saying that in Bakewell.
We have friends and relatives in the choir.
So, now, if you think that you can't do this, look, these are your people up here. You know, so next time, you're going to double the size of this group. And we got to get us some young folk up in here, too, because you know, we could use that energy, you know. No, not that y'all didn't have any, because y'all didn't. We were all nodding off at the end, I have to tell you. But thank you all so much. I also wanted to invite you all. I will be co-preaching with my brother here in the morning. And I want to say a little bit about what's going to be happening.
Oh,
invite folks.
Yeah, just if y'all enjoyed what you saw here today, I invite you to come to First Presbyterian Church tomorrow morning at 10:30. We're going to be co-preaching a sermon on the song "A Change Is Going to Come" by Sam Cooke. I've talked to Eric and actually singing the song and then teaching us about the song, and we're going to have a conversation where we look at that song, which was a beautiful anthem of the civil rights era that we're going to talk about. And so we welcome you to come to that 10:30 tomorrow morning at First Presbyterian Church. That's the one across the street from Russ's Market there on 7th and Lincoln.
Yes.